Rock, just to start off, before you, do you want to put the glass down?
Do you want me to put the glass down?
I'd like you to put the glass down.
Put the glass down.
Okay. That's very good.
Thank you.
Well done. Before you guys work together, and I'm going to ask you about when you first met and how it came about, but were you familiar with George Stevens' films?
Well, absolutely. I had seen most of the films without being aware of which director directed the films. In other words, as a kid back in Chicago, who cares who directed it and who was the sound man and who was the cameraman, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, as long as it starred so-and-so and so-and-so. I mean, that's all I cared about. Oh, yes, it's Cary Grant, or it's Katharine Hepburn, or it's what have you. So, although I had heard his name, I had heard of David Selznick. I didn't, as a young teenager, as a middle 15, 16-year-old, I didn't pay too much attention to those people, except that I was aware of their names. After I became an actor, then, of course, I, of course, did know George's names as everybody else's name, and cameramen and soundmen, too. But I saw most of the films, being a big movie fan mm-hmm. as a kid.
And when the opportunity came for you to work with him, what was your...
No, well, scrape me off the ceiling. I mean, it's thrill. The thrill of a lifetime for me. Because he had made so many excellent, perfect films, I think, that to work with him, get a chance to work with him, was really something for me. Plus, the role itself was a pretty good role to have. And also, I don't remember whether this was before I had met him or after. I can't sort that out in my mind because it was only last week, you see. But I asked a lot of people who had worked with him, what's it like to work with him? And they all, to one, said, just make yourself a piece of putty and put yourself in his hands. And he'll do it all. And I thought to myself, oh, well, yeah, but I mean, come on, an actor prepares. He must got to, you know what he's going to do, and he's going to so forth and so on. And so I, of course, was prepared. I don't mean by prepared not only knowing lines, but get an idea, a general idea of what I wanted to do. And it was all so easy with him and so effortless. The script was so well written that I didn't really have to sit down and learn lines. For example, I just ingested them and they just came out and the scenes just sort of flowed out. We had lunch someplace. And George had a way of looking at you and looking right through you. And you'd better tell the truth. That's it. He'd look. Well, of course, I got trying to be casual about all this and failing constantly. And I was practically saluting, Mr. Stevens, it's very nice to meet you. And of course, after an hour or so and a drink or two, I hope, I was calling him George. Well, now, George, what do you think about this? And he'd look at me. And I knew just by calling him George, I had made a mistake. Except I didn't. Except I did. Just, he kept me always on off balance, never trying, but he had to control as a director. Control is not a good word, yet it is control. and make me think it's my idea. He would go to great pains to go all the way around, over this way and that way, to make me think it's my idea, so that I would come up to him and say, George, I have a good idea for this scene. He'd say, what's that, Rock? And I'd tell him and say, yes, that's a good idea. And it was his all along. And he caught me every time. Every time. But it was really true that what everybody said, make yourself a piece of putty and put yourself in his hands and rely on him. And that was partly, I think, how a way of his to make the great films that he, and get the marvelous performances that he got out of people, because they just simply let it out.
Tell me, start by telling me how old you were when you did Giant, and a little bit about the thing of a young man playing a part that had to go.
Well, I was, let's see, 1955, I was 29, I think. 29, yeah. And I had to be in the movie, I had to be a young, in the young 20s, 23, 24, 25. And then middle age, I guess 45 to 50. And then older age, I guess 65 to 70, about. Incidentally, I don't know if I had told you this, a couple of years ago, I was in Chicago, and Giant was on being run on television late at night, and I just come back from the theater. And I don't like to watch films on television, particularly those that I am involved with. But I was curious. And so I knew when I would be the 45 to 50-year-old age, about what time, I tuned it in to look. And I looked at myself and ran to the mirror and looked in the mirror, and it was exactly the same, including where the gray is, where most of the gray is. To a T, it was exactly. So now I know what I'm going to look like when I'm 70.
Yeah, I thought of that when you walk in.
Really? Really?
Except you don't have the padding around the
No. Well, no. Some.
did George have humor?
He loved, yes, he had great, deep humor. As I remember, he never liked jokes, particularly. He loved to play gags on people. He was a devil. I never saw him break up laughing. He would be amused. He would smile a lot. But his humor was, for example, this might take a little while to tell. I hope I can tell it fast. I copied his walk when I was playing the old part, which was a kind of a portly walk. We never discussed it. And there was a scene where I had to walk from one room into the bedroom, around a bed, sit down and get on the phone, angry, mad. So I had to walk fast. Well, I didn't know how to do that fast, so I thought I'd be clever. I said, George, would you do me a favor? Would you walk around this bed and sit down? I want to see something. He said, sure. And the first time he came in like so, on tippy-toe, tit-tit-tit-tit-tit, and around the bed. Well, he started me laughing. Now, I have on a rubber face with appliances and, you know, the whole thing. I said, no, come on, I really... Oh, he said, I'm very sorry. And the next time he came in and did a pole vault right over the bed and landed in the spot and got on the phone. He said, is that what you want, Ron? Well, of course, I was laughing so hard now that all the makeup had cracked and broken off, and it's now 3 p.m, and the makeup man became irate because it was a long makeup, 3-hour makeup in the morning. And he read in the riot act. And George said, you're absolutely right, Frank, I'm very sorry. That's a wrap. We went all through the afternoon because it would have taken 3 hours to start all over again. But I mean, when he would do things like that, he was funny. He was a funny, funny man, but it was all very deep humor. As I say, he was not a surface man at all. I asked him one time, you know, and every time I asked him a question, it always came out stupid. I said, we were flying to Texas together. And I said, do you read much, George? Making conversation. And he gave me that look. And he said, yes, Rob, I read everything. Oh, I see. Well, back out the window I went.
Can we get to the end? Okay,
good. Cut. Who coming up?
Okay. Sounds strange to hear his voice.
Yeah. Just to ask that, I mean, hearing him talk, what, if you had to characterize him, what kind of a man was he?
Solid marble. A heavyweight, thorough, exhaust every avenue.
Was giant hard work?
No. No, I don't want to say it was easy, and yet it was easy. He made it easy.
How about on him? Was you recall whether it was tough on him or whether
it was tough on him? He would never let anybody know it. But well, okay, I'll tell you. I loved him. I followed him around like a puppy. I would worship that man, and so I saw perhaps a little more than maybe other people did on the set or in the cast, but he had a couple of ulcer attacks, and I guess there were some buttes. Tried never to let anybody know. He perspired a lot. Kept himself all bundled up in the heat of West Texas in the summer. I never understood that. When Jimmy Dean died, when we got word, we were all in the projection room watching dailies. Somebody came blubbering in and said, Jimmy just got killed. And George left. And I followed him. And we walked down through the sound stages, through Warner Brothers lot. And I lost him. I couldn't find him. I don't know where he went, why, where he was going, except to guess that he just wanted to be by himself for a while, or for how long he was there, I don't know. I gave up, left, went back. Everybody had left the projection room, gone home. I went home. Next day, he was not a particularly kind man. He and Elizabeth had a few words together. She was upset. And he was being, I thought at the time, cruel. He wasn't. He was trying to get her to stop thinking about it. Therefore, he was trying to crack the whip. To go and don't indulge yourself and don't think about it and go for it. And it didn't work. Not with Elizabeth.
Well, he had a couple of... I remember he was like a father to you. I mean, you guys were really pals.
Yeah.
Jimmy was a little... more was not that easy, was it?
Well, I don't think so. Of course, George, in his dealing with everybody in the cast, and in his direction, never was he was very private about it. He would take Jimmy aside to go for long walks to discuss a scene, or he would take me over and to discuss something and talk about the general, my general frame of mind. Because he made sure that my mind was Bick, Benedict. And as long as he was sure that my mind was there, was right, he let me go. That's why I'll never understand that one line that he gave me. Because he never gave me much a direction in terms of, you know, when you pick up the glass, put it over there before you say the word go, or whatever the direction was. But it was early on in shooting, and we were shooting a barbecue sequence out in West Texas. And the scene was where I was introducing my new wife, Elizabeth Taylor, to my friends, the Texas Ranchers. And I was going on about blah, 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 and this is so and so and so and so. And he came up, and he looked at me. He said, Rock, we've got a long way to go. Just an awful long way to go. And walked away. And I still have no idea what he meant. I see. I didn't know if he meant in shooting schedule or in... I don't know. And I was too embarrassed to say, I don't know what you're talking about, George. What do you mean? Tough in that we shot it for a week. Mm-hmm. A fight. I mean, I used to come home at night with my arms like this, thinking they're going to fall off any minute, you know.
Why do you think you shot so many?
Well, George, as you know, shot an awful lot of film, an awful lot of angles. I think that, I mean, several people have said he shot so much film from so many angles because he didn't know what he wanted. I never thought that. I always thought that if he's going to be a sculptor, he'd better have enough clay with which to make the bust, you know?
What was his office like? I mean, when you talked to Susan about, you go, that thing of creating an atmosphere of Texas, you felt the stuff up on the wall.
All the bulletin boards, yes. Mm. It was full of Texas. Full of Texas, all of it. Pictures of rodeos and photographs of Texans, different styles of clothes, and anything you can mention that had to do with the Southwest, really. Not just Texas, but the arid Southwest was all over, bulletin boards all over the office, split in half, going up one side and down the other, just to get this wonderful feeling of what he was trying to put on film.
When you were going to have to fight as an old man, was there some business where you asked him how do you fight as an old man?
Yes. I did say, you know, how does an old man fight? I've never seen an old man fight. He doesn't last, couldn't last very long, especially with a younger man, especially with a younger man as big as that man was. If I remember right, he was about 6'6 or 6'7. Big guy. Well, we cheated a bit and made it a nice, long, good movie fight. But I said, what about movement? What about throwing a punch and all of that? And if I remember right, I think he said, well, throwing a punch, I don't think an old man is any different than a young man. An old man will think the punch out a little bit more deliberate. Young man might be a little faster. But if it connects, it's going to be the same. But he did give me, for all of the old age, a skin diver's weighted belt, 50 pounds, I think it weighed, so that I had trouble in movement. In particular, like getting out of a chair, I had to really work to get out of the chair and or sitting down to fall in like an elderly person does, so I didn't have to play that. It was there. Which was, that was a good thing. Then I had this union suit on full of cotton, which was nice and cool, I remember. Oh, boy, was that hot.
I'm
going to
ask us to cut for
just a second.
Now,
marker for 63.
No.
Second stick, sorry.
Two sticks.
Remember?
I remember the, when that shot came on the screen, the whole audience went, oh, and just, we're heartbroken. Yeah. When Angel Obregon comes back.
And of course it was a pivot in the film, wasn't it? Because that led your character, who'd been resisting the...
Yeah.
What did you do, remember?
Bigot, Bic.
Yeah.
Well, I went to Elizabeth and I, Leslie and I went to the funeral.
But you went and got the flag out, remember?
I went and got the flag. Lone Star flag of Texas. Yeah. Gave it to his grandfather, old Polo. Yeah. I remember, were you there that day?
Don't remember.
I remember that we shot in a little village, I believe called Valentine, Texas. Mm-hmm. And several people were used as atmosphere or extras or what have you, local people, all elderly people. And we went through the service of the funeral. And they all sobbed. I remember that very well. I don't know, you know, why they were sobbing. Probably reminded them of perhaps a child or a grandchild, or perhaps a similar situation. But they all sobbed, all of them.
Well, you were young when you made that. Did you have any sense, that you think, of what George stood for? Or was that not?
No, I didn't. I only felt that it was dramatically correct. Mm-hmm. And a hell of a moment in the scene. And a hell of a third act ending. A second act ending.
Do you remember asking him, and if you remember this, if you'd start with the word comedies, about asking him, I mean, work the word comedies in the beginning of your answer. Did you ask him once why he didn't?
Yes. I said, George, you have made so many brilliant, brilliant comedies, romantic comedies, what have you, action comedies. Why don't you do some more? And he gave me that look. Well, Rock, they're just too much trouble. And walked away. He didn't permit me to say, what do you mean by that? Nothing. Gone. That was the end of that discussion.
You talked a little bit about his knowing the material, and perhaps another point, the sense of the real on the set, and then the picture, that things had to be real. Props, clothes, flowers, costumes.
Yes.
Could you talk about that a little bit?
No, I can't, actually. Yes, all the flowers in the wedding scenes, thousands of flowers were all... There was a whole florist shop over here on the side of the soundstage. I remember, get fresh flowers in for when they started to wilt, or bring in fresh flowers.
Let me ask you another question. The wedding scene, when you come back to West Virginia... How do you know how that emotion? I mean, that was when I saw the picture, I remember reading the script. It was so unexpected when I sensed that thing of you coming in behind.
Well, there are two things about that scene. First of all, there was a long shot. The scene was Elizabeth's younger sister gets married to Rod Taylor. And Elizabeth is the maid of honor, and we had just had a fight in Texas, and she went back with the kids. And then I'm too lonely, so I come back to get my wife and kids, and that's the situation when I walk in the door. It's a wedding. And so everybody gets caught up in the wedding and the wedding march, etc., which is very easily get caught up in, at, for, with, what, why. But I remember I had to be in the back of the crowd and to watch what was happening and then go into another room, the dining room, so I could sneak around in the corner and watch the wedding from the dining room, which is hidden and so forth and so on. And George said, "You're not tall enough. Can you walk on your tiptoes?" And I said, "Yes." So I walked on my tiptoes and I wasn't tall enough. Ended up, they built a ramp about 8 feet high behind all these people, about a 30-foot walk on this ramp. I mean, I'm 6'4" and I'm not tall enough. And I had to walk on this ramp behind these people through. But the other thing is, if you want me to tell about Elizabeth, myself, we didn't know each other then. That was the very beginning of shooting, because we had this one house set for two scenes, sequences, before we went on location. So it was at the very beginning of the film. And the night before, Elizabeth very nicely had asked my future wife and I to come over to she and Michael Wilding's house for dinner, have an evening of getting acquainted, and it's going to be a long time together and so forth. So it was very nice and very polite of her to do so, and we did. And we had a wonderful time, and it was a very liquid evening. And several martinis later, suddenly realize it's 3 a.m. and we have to get up and go to work and shoot this wedding scene. Well, Elizabeth had to get up, I guess, at 5:30. Girls don't have it as lucky as guys do. I'd get up around 6:30 or something. But we both were so dreadfully hungover, and we had to shoot this scene, this highly emotional scene, and not a word to each other, but just look at each other, just moony-faced. And we shot the scene and the sequence, and the hairdressers and the wardrobe girls and everybody were over there crying and carrying on. And the truth is, we were just so hungover that we couldn't do anything but just look. And that was it. And they thought, "Oh, that's beautiful acting. Beautiful acting." Dreadful. A dark day in my life.
Just a couple to wrap things up. Did you ever see, the people have observed that for all of these qualities that were appealing, did you ever see George very hard? I mean, could he be hard? And would you choose your own words to describe the?
Well, as I did tell you, it was hard with Elizabeth. Mm-hmm. When the next day after Jimmy died, he was hired a couple of times with Jimmy. I didn't hear too much of it because he took him away. But by his attitude and his stoniness with Jimmy and the way Jimmy was reacting, I knew something had happened where the two of them had added a bit. I know they did. I could see them 500 yards away going like this, you know, for a long time. But we never heard it. That was never discussed in front of anybody else.
And what about the mood on the set? Does that conjure up anything, or is it like all sets?
There was a definite feeling when you walked on the sound stage in particular, not so much location. Mm-hmm. But George was there to work. We all were there to work. So the set was quiet. so that people could concentrate, people could think. Usually when you walk on the set and the guys are removing the equipment, so they're talking and carrying on, it was all done in a very quiet manner, minimum of dialogue or discussion. Yes, put the light there and the scrim there and so forth and so on, but not general hubbub that you usually hear. And I remember the one set was on a big soundstage, and all of the dressing rooms were way at one end. And those of us who were not in the scene were in our various dressing rooms or any other dressing rooms and talking and carrying on. And they had hollered quiet. The assistant director came around and said, quiet, folks, we're going to roll the camera. Well, we were quiet, but we were quite a ways away from the set. So we'd be talking. And I happened to look out the window, and they had rolled a scene. And there's George walking by to make sure that we all shut up. And boy, did we clam up, all of us. And he went back to the set. Now we were quiet. And
I remember I've never had a loud assistant director to yell quiet, because he always felt that, you know, you get an actor just in the right mood for a scene, and then some guy says, quiet.
Well, I don't remember that so much, but I do remember the music. He had a little thing, a little box by the side of his chair, and a man over there playing two types of mood music. And depending upon the scene, he would turn up that volume. He'd roll the camera. They'd say, camera rolling. And he'd turn up the volume and just let that music play for a while. Set the mood. Turn the volume down and say action. And we just do it. Mm-hmm. One take, print.